name is Andrés Yarce Botero. I'm nowadays a student from the PhD Mathematical Engineering Program in Universidad EAFIT. I'm a student of the Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. Today, I'm going to present you what I name conciliating models with reality, the variational data assimilation technique. My professors are Nicolás Pinel, Professor Olga Lucía Quintero, and the Professor Arnold Henning. First of all, I'm going to present the problem that made me exciting to research in this line. Then I'm going to introduce you to the inverse modeling mathematical problem. Following that, we're going to study the mathematical background of the variational data assimilation technique. Then I'm going to present an example with a model, the Lorentz 63 model of the variational technique. And finally, we are going to explain my current and future work. Well, as you know, we are I'm part of a project which is named is MAUI project, a project of different professors of the university are working together in order to propose different solutions to the contamination problem that we have in the city. This image I'm showing you in a different perspective what happened in two times when we are experiencing the contingency phenomenon. Those are satellite images taken this year in March 6 and 11. Notice here how the smoke concentration appears, but this concentration not always is stuck in the city. What happened is that due to different phenomena, due to meteorological dynamics, this contamination is propagated, is transported, and constantly is being deposited in different areas, in water reservoirs, for example, causing a problem which is now the eutrophication, an excess of nutrients and contaminants, and also ozonification, which is a problem when there is a high critical level or ozone deposited in the leaves of the plants, and it changes the behavior functional behavior. These order the ideas and with this problem that there is a question that arrives to me, which is what, how much, and when is being emitted if we know how much is being deposited in different protected natural areas. In this order of ideas, we can think in a cause and effect problem, which introduce us in the area of the mathematical of the inverse modeling. To start talking about the inverse modeling, let's read the reference of the famous character Sherlock Holmes, and we say that most people, if you describe a train of events to them, will tell you what the result will be. There are a few people, however, that if you told them as a result, would be able to evolve from their own inner consciousness what the steps were that lead to that result. This power is what I mean when I talk of reasoning backward. I use this reference to exemplify what is an inverse problem. An inverse problem, as the word said, is in contrast to the direct problems. This could be understood also as the way that the problem is well posed or imposed. This characteristic is when the problem we are analyzing fulfilled some statements, which are the existence of the solution, the uniqueness of the solution, and the stability. If a problem doesn't fulfill these statements, could be said that it's an inverse problem. Let's do a mental exercise to understand that this kind of problem that I'm explaining to you. If, for example, we know the forces that are being pushing an object, and if we want to from them to know the trajectory, we are working in a direct problem. And by the other hand, if we have the trajectory of a body and we want to know what are the forces that causes this trajectory, we are thinking backward in an inverse problem. So in the problem of the pollution transported to another areas, I say that I'm working in an inverse problem, and for know what the answer to the question, I'm going to use a technique which is known that assimilation. For this, first we start knowing that we have a model. As you know, we are working with a model that is named Lotus Euros. I'm going to talk later about that. And this model represents the reality, but is not accurate in many cases. We have, by the other hand, measurements of reality. In these images, you can see, for example, how the footprints of the satellite retrieve information looks like. Using these two things, we are going to talk about the data simulation methodology, a way to incorporate data from different sources to a model to improve the representation it gives us. And that's why in the last seminar, I start briefly introducing this methodology and explaining the different groups that exist. Today, I'm going to affirm that I'm going to work in this line, the variational assimilation methods. And to do that, let's understand this cycle that are the principal milestone in a problem of data simulation, variational data simulation. We have measurements of the reality, and we will work in a constant analysis of a window time. We have a forward or direct model of the real world, and using the adjoint model, we can calculate a gradient that constantly in an optimization cycle is getting us the minimization difference of the observation and measurement that we want to obtain the initial condition. Let's start deeply in this order of ideas to understand. Consider some physical system here as the truth, and this is a physical phenomena that evolves through the time. From this phenomena, we can have measurements. The measurements are expressed in this way, in which the states are being mapped to the observation operator, and there is an error associated. We have a model in, to represent this reality. This model in the initial condition in, let's understand as the background. This model also has his model operator, which propagates the states and the parameters. Let's understand that the model is not perfect. It has an error associated, and also that happened with the observations. That's the next step that we are now. We want to find what is the best initial condition to that generates a trajectory that minimizes the difference in a window time of the model output in relation with the measurements. This is what we're doing in the with the gradient in the backward or adjoint model. In this, from this is we continue with the optimization cycle to have the better output. The idea here is to find the best distance that which is composed by a cross-functional from the distance between the background and the initial condition and the observations and the analysis step during the window time. There are two principal groups, which are the static and the dynamic data variational assimilation. In the static, we don't have the time dependence, and we build our functional, which is composed by the distance to the forecast and the distance to the observations. Here you have the background state, the background error covariance matrix, the observation operator, the observation error covariance matrix, and the vector of observation. In the other case, when you have a dependence of time, you are going to announce the functional in the when we analyze it in a window of time, taking S measurements. Okay, I'm going to start here talking from an example in which we are going to study how the gradient expression is retrieved, which is an important expression that we have to have in order to minimize the functional in the optimization cycle. Let's start having a linear system in which we assume that the model is perfect. So we are going just to take the observation distance and imagine and suppose that we just have observation in the last time, the time is. From here, you can have a model that represent the propagations, the S propagations from the initial condition. Introducing this in the expression, we have vary this this functional, we have the expression, the following expression, and using the vector, and using the product, the scalar product, we can express the variance of this functional in the following way. Here is important to know that we are going to use the a property of the scalar product in which the matrix transposed is named, is well known as the adjoint matrix. In this term, the adjoint matrix is equivalent in this way, and by the definition of the variance of the functional respect to the initial condition, that is the product, the scalar product between the gradient and the variance in the initial condition, we know that the gradient expression is the first part that we have in this equation. And what is the thing with this adjoint? We need the expression of the adjoint to know how the model is propagated backward in time. And what happened is that in systems with high scale, with a lot of number of states, what is the situation we have in the with the Lotus Euros, the atmospheric chemical model, is complicated to find it, because we have to make the tangent linear model, which is the linear representation of a nonlinear system that has a lot of vector states and a lot of states, and you have to make the derivation of this vector of states by each one of the states. That is difficult to get, and if you get, also has a lot of computational associated time. This is one of the reasons that we don't have an adjoint from the Lotus Euros model, and we can apply the variational data simulation technique directly. Having the expression of the gradient, there is a process, and I'm not going to explain deeply, it's an optimization cycle in which there are different techniques to find the local or the global minima of a continuous function. We are going to explain here with the Lorentz 63 model how this technique works. The Lorentz 63 model is a deterministic chaotic model which is useful to use to test the assimilation methodologies. It's important to know here that also it's a model that is related to the nonlinear dynamics of the atmosphere, and that's the reason I select to start testing the variational approaches. This model has three states and three parameters, and there is a generalization of the model in which you, in the Lorentz 96, in which there are multiple numbers of states. Let's see in this video how a trajectory that evolves through the states evolve in a deterministic way, and it's important to know that is a model in which the the evolution is highly sensitive to the initial condition. That happens here, for example, when in three cases, just varying a little the initial condition, the evolution of the states in one moment is not possible to predict. So we are going to apply the data assimilation variational technique in this problem. Let's start defining the truth. And from the truth, we are going to define select synthetic observation data, generate the observation, and there are two, and in this time, we are knowing what is the analysis time. There are two sections in this graph, analysis window, that is the time period in which we are constantly finding the gradient to find the best initial condition, and the forecast window in which we predict to the future the behavior of the estimation. Once we have the observations, we generate what is known the background. The background is generated from an initial condition that is slightly different to that is different from the initial condition we have. And from this, we are going to start the optimization cycle. This model has a joint, and from this adjoint, we build the expression for the gradient, and we start on the different criteria of stop optimizing the output. To have a functional that represents in the best initial condition the output desired. You can see here how the analysis is during the time changing of initial condition and propagating being more near to the observations. That's what I tried to present with the title of the presentation, how to conciliate models with observations. These two terms in the functional that we propose are the terms that are where the errors, the covariance of the error are expressed. If you change these errors, you make that the analysis that you are going to find are going to be more near to the observation or more near to the model. That's happened, for example, in the other situation when the analysis step now is going closer to the background. Noting here that the forecast window not represent the background properly from one time in the future. Okay. Having this in mind, I have been studying the background techniques, the techniques, the variational techniques. But what happened with this model that we are working in the group is that we cannot apply directly this data assimilation technique because the high nonlinear dynamics associated and the high number of states. Nowadays, remember the start of the presentation, we can generate this kind of outputs that are the position of different contaminants in the zone of the study. At this time, I'm working the way to simplify a case of a study, knowing that we can simulate outputs, we can retrieve information for several data from satellites. So we have information measured, and in the experiments that I'm doing now, propose a variational technique to estimate the correct emission rates from the city of Medellin that is being affected and other places, natural protected areas. This is operational schematics of the variational technique that I am proposing. It is composed collect data from different satellites that retrieve information for NO2 and NH3, and from this there is a process of processing the data, mapping to the kernel sensitivities that we have to compare appropriately with the model, and once we have the data in a proper way, we are going to make the assimilation procedures to improve the estimation of the emission rates. Finally, I am at this time identifying that there are different new points of view of how to deal with the problem of the adjoint. There are basically two big groups of adjoint-free methods or adjoint-free perspectives. There is the model order reduction model for DBAR, in which there is a way to find a reduced state from the big state vector that we have that has a correct representation, and we can find an adjoint on a minor degree of freedom. In the other side, in the ensemble for the bar, we are using here what we know as an ensemble. The ensembles are a propagation of different trajectories near from the initial condition that approximate the statistic behaviors of the model. Nowadays, I am studying what is the best option to continue to generate data simulation based on the variational approach with the results of the model. So this is the end of my presentation. There are references, and if you have questions, I'm happy to answer it.